Site 8, The Cemetery. From the Diary of Joshua Gregory. Joshua Gregory was a soldier on board the brig Governor Phillip, moored off Cascade on the 21st of June, 1842, when a mutiny attempt occurred by a group of convicts intent on taking the boat and sailing away to freedom. His diary entry captures the drama of the unfolding and ultimately unsuccessful attempt.
It was my turn to go on sentry until six. I had been posted but a very few minutes when orders were given to put the brig about. I had told two of the convicts to come on deck. Instead of two, four made their appearance. I said I only call for two, and that is all I want. So two of you can go below again. But they seemed to take no notice of what I said, still making their way up the forehatch. I leveled my pistol at the head of the first of them and said if he moved one step further, I'd blow out his brains. This rather cooled their mettle. They could see I was in good earnest and made no further attempt to advance. Two of the men went below again, muttering something I could not make out. When the brig had been put about and all made fast, I sent the other two below with a caution to be more civil the next time they were called. At 6 o'clock, I was relieved by another man. In giving up my orders, I was most particular in pressing on his mind my suspicions, and told him to have a sharp eye on them when any of them came on deck, and not allow more than two on deck at a time. I then went below to take a little sleep, if possible. I threw myself into my berth, never taking off any of my clothes, for I had no intention to lie any time. The rest of our party was fast asleep. After tumbling about for some time, I fell off in a dreamy slumber. But how long I had been asleep, I cannot tell. When I was awake by the report of a musket and a great scuffle and noise on deck just above my head, I sprang to my feet, seized the first musket that came to my hand, and rushed up the main hatch. At the same moment, the sergeant was making his way below, bleeding dreadfully from wounds in his head. He had nothing on but his trousers. He looked a most pitiful spectacle. I had hardly gained the deck when I received a heavy blow on my head with a cutlass, which sent me head over heels and down the ladder again. The blood streamed down my face fearfully, almost blinding me by running to my eyes. I made another attempt to gain the deck and had succeeded in planting one foot thereon when two of the mutineers rushed at me, sword in hand. I defended myself as long as I could, but another blow on my head sent me reeling down the ladder again. Again I tried to get on deck, but received the same dose, this time getting two wounds, one on the head just above my left ear, carrying a piece of skull away along with the flesh and hair. The other wound I received was across the back of my fingers. I then had in all four wounds, three on my head and one on my hand. After recovering myself a little, I got a comrade to tie a handkerchief about my head to somewhat staunch the blood. By this time the mutineers had made themselves masters of the upper deck. Two of our fellows were thrown overboard, one sank immediately and never was seen more. The other, being a good swimmer, managed to reach the barge where he got in and concealed himself. The rest of us were driven below. The beginning of the mutiny was as follows. About a half an hour after I went below, the two convicts that came on deck to look after their barge suddenly rushed upon the two sentries, disarming them and driving them below, and also possessed themselves of six stands of arms that were placed on the quarterdeck, besides two pistols and two swords that they took from the sentries, which nearly completed the arming of them. The crew was all made to go into their barge. One of the crew only they kept purposely to steer the ship. One of the mutineers stood over him with the loaded pistols. The hatches were fastened down. Everything of any weight was thrown on to prevent us from getting on deck. We were in a nice mess, and for some time at a standstill how to act. At length we tore down the bars of the prison, and also the partition that divided our apartment from the cabin. We then had a clear run from stern to stern, and every time we saw the shadow of a mutineer through any crevice or hole in the hatches, we took a deliberate aim, and every shot either killed or wounded some of them. It was proposed to saw into the beam that supported the main hatch, so that by doing so the hole would fall in and give us a free passage up. Several of us had assembled under the hatch for that purpose. The carpenter had commenced his task and had succeeded in cutting 3 or 4 inches into the beam when all at once about a dozen buckets of boiling water was thrown down on us by the cowardly rascals, scalding 3 or 4 of our fellows and the carpenter very severely on his head, arms and chest. This forced us to desist from our purpose and get under cover, but we harassed them so much by firing at them through the opening in the hatches that they were afraid to move about the decks to trim the sails, and consequently they were allowed to hang loose and the brig left to drift with the tide. We had been in this situation more than an hour when one of the mutineers called down the cabin hatch and said if we could give them provisions, a compass, a cask of water and a large sail, they would take a boat and leave the brig. Captain Boyle was about to comply with their wishes when one of our men said if he gave them 1 ounce of our provisions, he would shoot him. We then gave the mutineers to understand that they should have nothing from us but a few ounces of lead and we should either recapture the brig or she should be our coffin. The answer we got was that not one of us should escape. At this time, me and 2 more were in the cabin, looking up for a chance shot at some of the rascals that we saw now and then peeping at us through the skylights. I went into the captain's sleeping apartments and found on a small table a bottle, about 3 parts full of brandy. I soon made it known to the other 2, and in less time than it takes me to tell it, it disappeared down our throats. I found it greatly revived me, for I had lost a considerable quantity of blood and began to feel very weak. We had scarcely reached the cuddy table when Captain Boyle went bustling into his sleeping cabin to get a pull at the brandy bottle, as I suppose. But in a few seconds he appeared again at the door with the empty bottle in his hand and roared out, "Who the devil's been in this room and drank all my brandy?" In the midst of the confusion and din of the mutiny, the old tar was calmly and seriously trying to discover the plunderers of his brandy bottle. But we firmly denied all knowledge of it, so he, of course, had to give up his inquiry, but promised, when all was quiet, to renew it again. In spite of the danger that surrounded us, we were forced to give a hearty laugh that we had strove to suppress. But other works besides laughing was in store for us, for at this moment we saw 2 of the mutineers cautiously watching us through the skylights. They were both armed with swords and pistols. When they saw us looking at them, they drew back their heads. One of them stooped down behind the frame of the skylight, thinking, I suppose, that he was out of our reach there. But he was sadly mistaken, for the wood was only 2 inches thick and not hard enough to resist a bullet. A shot was fired through it, which was instantly followed by an agonizing shriek, and afterwards by groans and sobs. We knew that the shot had taken effect and laid another of their gang aside, which at the beginning amounted to 12. The other one was also doomed, for he was shot through the head by Captain Boyle, whilst in the act of looking at us through the skylights. This left the cabin hatch unguarded, and in a moment the brave old captain sprung up the ladder, followed by the rest of us. We had scarcely gained a footing on the quarterdeck when they attacked us with fury of devils, but we poured in 1 deadly volley that staggered them a little. When the smoke cleared away, we found 4 of them lying dead at our feet. The others retreated to the forecastle, but we followed them up and wounded 3 more of them. 2 of them jumped overboard. 1 made for the barge and got in, but he was seen from the brig and pierced by 3 bullets and instantly expired. One of our own men in the confusion was shot by the sergeant. He lived for several weeks after. I was the only one that saw it done excepting the sergeant, and he hardly knew what he was about. When the living mutineers were captured and placed under care of sentries, we made signals of distress to the people on Ailen. In about an hour after, Governor McConachie, 3 doctors and several officers, civil and military, came on board. The deck presented a sickening spectacle, for the dead lay in one place and the wounded in another, and step where we would, we could not avoid treading in blood. One fellow lay under the foremast with only half a head. The other half was shot away. A part of his brains was blown onto the mast just above the foreyard, and there it stuck for more than 3 months. But what was worse still was a large pig that escaped from its sty, devouring the remaining half. There was 4 of our fellows wounded and 1 overboard and drowned. There was 5 of the convict mutineers killed and 3 wounded.